Good morning, good afternoon, good evening, wherever you are tuning in. My name is Mariana Castaño Cano, and it is my pleasure to welcome you to COP26 TV, with an incredible guest today, someone who's at the top of one of the more active UN climate programs working for the environment and for the climate. I have today here with me Inger Andersen, the executive director of the UN Environment Program. Inger, hello.
Hi, it's such a pleasure to be here. Thank you.
Thank you for giving us some of your time in these last hours of COP26. It's been very, very busy. The UN Environment Program is a very agile and active organization, but at the COVID time, even the most agile organization has had to deal with unexpected situations. We are in the middle of a triple crisis, a climate crisis, an environmental crisis, and now a health crisis. How has the pandemic affected the work of the UN Environment Program?
I would say that it really forced us to focus, because we understood that a pandemic that emerged, where did it come from? Mm-hmm. Well, in fact, 75% of all infectious diseases are zoonotic in nature, zoonosis. They come from the animal world, jumping from the wild animals through a transmission animal into the human world. MERS, SARS, bird flu, and of course many other diseases. And so that led us to really focus on one of the triple planetary crises, the biodiversity and nature loss crisis. But we also work very much on the climate crisis and of course on the pollution and waste crisis. These three planetary crises that we speak about are underpinned and driven by unsustainable consumption and production. And that's what we're talking about here. How are we going to reduce the footprint, whether it be in energy, whether it be in transport, whether it be in buildings, whether it be in agriculture, so that we have a more sustainable future?
Absolutely. Living in a compatible way with the planetary boundaries in the end.
Absolutely. Living such that we can reach the sustainable development goals, and ensuring that we, as we make those transitions that are necessary and difficult, leave no one behind.
Mm-hmm. The United Nations Environment Programme, since 12 years now, has been monitoring the gap between the commitments of nations on emission of gas reductions and what we need to do to be limiting the increase of the global average temperature to 1.5 degrees, as science is telling us is the safest space for human life as we know it. You, from your perspective, having seen this gap, which is not being breached, unfortunately, what is the greatest learning from the latest report?
Well, look, we issue a trilogy of three reports. We issue the production gap report, where we look at, okay, what are the plans for coal, oil, and gas? And they are going up, even if countries have a different plan. So 240% more coal, 70-something percent more gas, 50-something percent more oil. So that was the first report. Then we issue the emissions gap report, which you ask about. That gap report tells us that we have shaved off 7.5% of our emissions. Good, but not good enough, because we need to shave off nearly 50% to head to 1.5 degrees. So we need to get much more ambitious. Now, we just the other night issued an update on the emissions gap report, and we say, well, even with those new NDCs that have come in, we're still heading for the 2.7 degrees, so we need to get more ambitious. When we take on board the net zero commitments, then we can see that, okay, even though they're vague, they're unclear, they are kicking the can down the road beyond 2030, and they are not officially committed to the UNFCCC process, but we took them on board nevertheless. That lands us at 2.2 degrees. Right now we emit about 55 gigatons of carbon into the atmosphere every year. With these NDCs, we've taken out 4.8 gigatons. We should have taken out 55. So that is not going to take us where we need to go, which is why we and the Secretary General and the UN in general are calling for greater ambition and for more stretch. This is the time, this is the moment, that is what we need to have happen here.
Absolutely. And in this COP we are hearing a lot about collaboration and about having the job actually done. It's not about the what, it's not about the why, it's about the how. The UN Environment Programme is helping governments and non-party stakeholders in the how, through policy, through financing of programs, and through capacity building. Could you let us know a little bit more about the work that you're doing to support climate action?
Oh, that is a big question, but look, we are working in pretty much everywhere. We're not doing the big investments. There you have the multilateral development banks and others. But we are doing those shifts that can be enabling to something bigger. So for example, used vehicle imports, right? Africa imports a vast amount of used vehicles, but they are substandard many times. And so we worked with the exporters and the importers to get to at least Euro 4. And now the ECOWAS region has instituted rules that they will only allow importation of a certain standard of vehicle that has lesser emissions. Now, this is good for so many points of view, from childhood asthma to CO2 emissions to road safety. You have many benefits here. We're also working on the cooling sector because we know that when people say cooling, they often think about air conditioners. We think about the cold chain for food, for medicines, but of course also about better buildings. And so we're working with many countries to introduce a better cool chain, smarter ways of doing it, so that we can do enable that foods get to markets before they rot. And that's good for the farmer, it's good for our overall health, and certainly good for the economy. And as under the Kigali Amendment, we are phasing out certain HFCs that have very high impact on climate. This is also a very smart way of moving forward. We're also working, obviously, on smart building and construction, ensuring that we reuse rather than just and that we reduce the kind of CO2 intensity, and we have much smarter and more energy efficient buildings. And of course, on the other side, we work on resilience, on adaptation in a very, very big way. Investing in nature's infrastructure, coral reefs protection, coastal sand dunes, coastal forests, integrating the green into the built environment in cities, making smart infrastructure investments for green and positive, helping countries to make that lift. These are some of the things that we do, but it's a very broad question and we do a lot. And it's absolutely critical, of course, which is why we call on more finance. We promised back in 2009 that there shall be $100 billion on the table. If we index that to inflation, it's a lot more today, let's be honest. And so it's regrettable that we are only around 80 billion or so, and this has to be delivered for the trust gap and the leadership gap to be narrowed.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's a matter of living up to the promises that were made many years ago. But we're talking about billions here, but the real picture is accounted in terms of trillions, and not just as a cost, but also as an economic opportunity. Because the inaction has a cost as well. And I would like to ask you one question about adaptation specifically, because we hear a lot about gigatons and emission gaps, but I would like to know from your perspective and maybe a little bit about the adaptation gap report, where are the biggest challenges in order to have the adaptation effort moving forward in a much faster way?
So we also issue the third report, which is the adaptation gap report, which looks at, okay, so if we are headed to a climate-changing world, which we are, what do we need to do to prepare ourselves for that? And what have countries done? The good news is that more and more countries, 71% of countries, have actually got adaptation plans in place and have got real action behind them, not just talk. That's very positive. The bad news is that the funding is still not in place in many places. But the kind of action that we need to see is, of course, that that can give people more resilience. Why is this difficult? It's difficult on one hand because of the funding, but it's also difficult because it requires a degree of government leadership that sets the regulatory guardrails. Are you going to build a seawall? Are you going to invest in a mangrove? And if you invest in the seawall, well, there is interest behind that in terms of the supplier of the cement and the builder, etc. If you invest in a mangrove, it means empowerment of the women, probably. So you need to figure out how to make that the other example, the mangrove or the coastal sand dunes or the coastal forests or the integrating of floodplains into city planning for city parks, for children's parks, so that when there are no floods, well, they can be nice parks. When there is a flood, they can be floodplains that fill with water and absorb the water. This is harder, but we're seeing more and more mayors leaning in. We're seeing more and more communities standing up, self-organizing, and holding their governments to account and saying, we can do this, if only with a little help. And there, UNEP, UNDP, and many, many other NGOs and self-organized communities are making this happen. Not with the speed that we want to see, because we're seeing these climate disasters across the world, but with a greater emphasis and a greater urgency than we did before.
We can read from your words, Inger, that it is not about working against nature, but working with nature and building with nature. And I would like to ask you about buildings. Today is the Cities, Regions and Built Environment Day, and the UN Environment Programme is very much involved in this agenda. The Secretariat of the Global Alliance for Buildings and Construction is hosted by UNEP. The numbers are also mind-blowing when we come to buildings. Buildings and construction account for 37% of the energy-related greenhouse gas emissions, according to the Global Status Report that you published just a few days ago. And I invite everybody to go and check the numbers, because those numbers also tell us that this is a ticking time bomb, because people need housing, especially in the developing world. They need housing and infrastructures. And in just 40 years, we are going to build as much buildings as they are standing today, which is really incredible. How do we make sure that we not only build back better, but that we build the future buildings in a resilient and decarbonized manner?
So we speak a lot about building back better, and we need to do that. But we actually just need to build better. When we think about construction, engineering, etc., we add in new housing stock footprint about the equivalent of the size of Paris every week. Every week, we're adding new buildings equivalent of the size of Paris. And so we have a choice. Are we going to build the usual, or are we going to build for the future? And there is, so we often think about energy and energy efficient buildings, and that is important. But we also need to think about the materials that we use for the building itself. Is it fresh cement, or is it recycled from older buildings? 99% it is new building material, new iron, new steel, new glass, new wood, new cement. That has a very heavy carbon footprint. We need to think about circular economy in building and construction. And then we need to think about the way we design. Are we designing for natural breeze, or are we designing for air conditioning? Are we designing for energy efficiency with greater insulation, be it from heat or from cold, etc.? Are we designing using geothermal energy? Are we designing with white or green roofs, etc.? And the problem is that we are not adopting these new practices as fast as we can. Why? Because whilst many of our NDCs include buildings, many of the same countries do not yet have building codes and building standards. And so this is an area where UNEP is working with countries, enabling that, you know, they actually would be greatly benefiting. It would bring down the costs of the tenants or the owners of the buildings. It would bring down the cost of the long-term maintenance. But it would certainly also bring down the CO2 footprint and make the buildings healthier. as I said, natural breeze in places where this is the way that you can heat or cool your buildings. So there's a lot to be done here. We know that the CO2 emissions are from these three big areas, or obviously energy, we know that, obviously transport, but buildings are often overlooked, which is why I'm really glad that we have this day today that focuses on this.
Absolutely. Well, we hear often that buildings are the sleeping giant for climate action, and a sleeping giant sometimes can be woken up to help us make a giant step, but also it can be, as we said before, a ticking time bomb. Before we go, Inger, I would like to ask you something about this worldview shift that we need. We need to be with nature, work with nature, build with nature, not against nature. Do you hope that out of this COP26 here in Glasgow, we will see operating this change of paradigm?
Well, I think what I really am pleased about was that nature was put firmly on the agenda by the COP presidency. And I'm also very pleased to see that there is a clear bridge from this COP to COP15 of the Biodiversity Convention, which will be held in May in Kunming, China. If Paris COP15 was a big one, where we made some big decisions on the Paris Accord, Kunming is a big one for biodiversity. We're going to agree on a new framework that has to be ambitious, etc., for biodiversity. And the beautiful thing about the Rio Conventions, the desertification too, is that they come together very nicely and they reinforce each other. They're indivisible. And so, yes, I do think that one of the elements that we are seeing, you know, everybody knew climate change. Few people knew nature's role in all of this and understood how species and ecosystems work in the hydrological cycle, in the heat waves, in the ocean oscillation. Few people had an understanding of this. I think there's more understanding now on the imperatives here. And this COP has lifted our awareness. So that's certainly something that I'm happy about.
Well, thank you very much, Inger Andersen, Executive Director of the United Nations Programme for the Environment. Thank you very much. And thank you very much to every one of you who followed up us today. I invite you to keep checking what's up at COP26 television, on social media, and on the unfccc.int website. Thank you very much, and stay safe.
Thank you.